This event will determine the NCAA champion in the 200-yard freestyle, the record holder, American and NCAA, Rowdy Gaines, 133.80. Rowdy, by the way, is the hero of the swimmer in lane four, the Golden Bear from California, Matt Biondi. He was the fastest qualifier in this morning's heats, and you just can't get this guy out of the pool. When he's not swimming, he's playing water polo. Next to him in lane three, a junior from Florida, Mike Heath. He is the defending champion in this event, and he is so well known for the strong charges that he possesses. In lane five, a couple over, Mike O'Brien, a freshman from Southern Cal. He was the Olympic gold medalist in the 1500-meter freestyle last summer, so freestyle is his discipline. The rest of the field, Rich Sager from SMU in lane one. Don Berger from Alabama in lane two. Heath in three, Biondi in four, O'Brien in five. Chris Jacobs from Texas in six. Thomas Farner from Ecully, France, originally a West German, will be in lane seven. And Michael Sutherland, a junior from California who calls Sweden home, will be in lane eight.
Gentlemen, 200 yard freestyle. Take your mark.
So look for the pace to be set in the center of the pool. Three Heath, Biondi four, O'Brien five. Lane one, top of your screen. Lane eight on the near side.
It's important to remember that in this 200-yard freestyle, unlike long course swimming where you have less turns, here you'll have seven turns. And it's the swimmer that's able to turn the fastest and the quickest that'll be able to get an early lead. Biondi is an expert at doing that. Right now he's underneath the American record split time at the 50-yard mark. Keep in mind, it is eight laps of the pool. They're now just completing the third lap.
Matt Biondi from the University of California, right now just a little fingertip in front of the field.
A lot of these swimmers will be using a six-beat kick as opposed to, say, a two-beat kick that the distance swimmers use. That means that they're kicking six beats for every complete arm rotation left and right that gets completed in the stroke.
Mark Biondi has now fallen off the record pace, but there another great turn for this exciting 6'6" sophomore, and this is the part of the race he can excel at.
In the prelims earlier today, he went out slow and he came back fast, and that's exactly what he's doing. Right now he has two laps left, 50 yards to go. He's still above his American record time, but he's got now another lap and a half to try to get back underneath it. He's being pressured awful closely by O'Brien in five and Heath in lane number three.
Clearly in front, Matt Biondi.
Keep in mind that the time he set in the morning was 134.36. The American record, 133.80.
And Biondi touches at 133.22. And that is a new American and NCAA record.
I told you he was going to come back fast. He did exactly that in the prelims, and he did it again tonight.
Well, his hero, Rowdy Gaines, may have a few things to say about that. In second place, in lane three, Mike Heath from the defending Florida Gator team. And in third position, in lane six, Chris Jacobs from Texas. Thomas Farner, who represented West Germany in the Olympics, a disappointing fifth.
Hi, everybody. I'm Al Troutwig. Welcome to the Lone Star State. We actually, today, will see many stars, not only from the United States, but from around the world. Some of these stars have proven themselves at the past Olympic Games. We have eight gold medalists, seven from the United States, and 18 medalists overall. In what makes up a very unique collection of athletes, these swimmers. Some of them with their heads shaved, some of them insulating themselves from the world with a Walkman, and some of them exuberant with their enthusiasm for this sport. Working along with me is Mark Spitz. And Mark, I think we want to begin by focusing in on some of these individuals.
Well, Al, there's a lot of individuals, especially Olympians, that are represented by the colleges, and Stanford University is no exception. They have Pablo Morales, perhaps the best butterfly swimmer in the United States today. He won three medals in the Olympic Games last year, and two NCAA titles, and is expected to at least do the same again this year for Stanford University. His teammate, John Moffitt, if you recall last year at the Olympic Games, had to withdraw from one of the breaststroke events because of a pulled groin muscle. Well, that muscle is healed, and he is swimming very well. And then there's young Matt Biondi of California. He's one of the new and up-and-coming freestyle sprinters in America today. Let me also point out, Al, that a lot of these Olympians took about 6 months off vacation, and they've had very short swimming seasons, and this will prove either detrimental or beneficial in whether or not they're in top form here.
And after the 200 freestyle in this multi-day event, in the team standings, we see Stanford leading two-time defending champion Florida by 5 points. We should also tell you that points are awarded not only in the final here, but in the consolation final as well. So from a team standpoint, every finish is important. Also, this is a 25-yard pool, a short course, and it differs in that regard from a long course 50-meter pool. And because it's measured in yards, we will only have American and NCAA records and not world marks.
Hey, you want to know how to make a car sing? Well, after you wash it, just get out the old Armor All. First I do the tires. Makes them look like new again. Then I do the bumpers. Makes them look like bumpers again, yeah. Then I do the dash, the door panels. Then I hit the hoses. And when I'm finished with Armor All, this car is the envy of the entire living world.
And then he does his car.
Company car.
It was incredible out there today. I had to work for every point. My muscles feel sore, but they won't for long because I've got Bengay. You can feel it working right away. You know, I also use Bengay before I play. It helps me warm up and play more comfortably, longer. And that can make the difference. Like today.
Bengay before and Bengay after. Feel better with Bengay.
You can feel it working right away.
It ain't easy to do rope tricks the first time around. Same goes for smokeless tobacco. But here's one that's easier to use. Skoal Long Cut. Now, it's not chewing tobacco. Long Cut means that it packs easy. Stays put between your cheek and gum. So Skoal Long Cut makes it easy to enjoy tobacco without lighting up. Plus, it's got the great taste that can only come from Skoal. Easy to use, great taste. Try Skoal Long Cut. It's a lot easier than this.
It hugs the road with bulldog tenacity. It's warranted for 30,000 miles, yet it costs under $30. This impressive automotive accomplishment isn't in the car. It's on the car. The Sears Guardsman Radio. Two steel belts and a 30,000-mile warranty for less than $30.
There's more for your life.
Confidence installed.
At Sears.
The conference-leading Houston Gamblers, led by quarterback sensation Jim Kelly, shoot it out against exciting Doug Flutie and the New Jersey Generals. Action begins live at 2:30 Eastern tomorrow on the USFL.
We are ready now for the 100-yard breaststroke. Four laps of the pool here on the campus of the University of Texas. The record holder in this event is the former SMU Mustang and Olympic gold medalist, Steve Lundquist. His record time, 52.48, he set the record in 1983. Our original focus will come in lane four for this race. John Moffitt, a junior at Stanford, his home Costa Mesa, California. One of the real tragic stories of the past Olympic Games, he was lost somewhere in the glory of the American swimmers. He has gone to sleep so many times with the American dream, but in 1980, it was shattered politically. In 1984, it was shattered physically. All times were emotional.
It was bright and sunny for the 100-meter breaststroke qualifying heat in L.A., but a dark day for John Moffitt. In the race, John clocked the second fastest time ever, only 300ths of a second off his world record time. The crowd cheering his smiling face, not knowing under the water there was a groin muscle in tremendous pain. But Olympic dreams are cast in emotional stone and leg-taped. John headed into the final. In that race, John lost that dream, finishing fifth, and lost his world record to a triumphant Steve Lundquist. Later, a poolside hug between the two as Lundquist tried to say, "I understand." The muscle could carry him no longer, and John Moffitt had to withdraw from the Olympic Games. Donna DeVerona asked him how he handled this difficult time.
I just tried to pay attention to what was going on, you know, because, you know, every person that came into the dorm with a gold medal, I'd feel so much jealousy, and it was just hard not to show it, and that's was my main thing, is not to show it to anybody how I felt, you know, because they still had to swim.
You've had two very difficult disappointments as an Olympic athlete, one in 1980, one in 1984. What have you learned from those experiences?
I looked at it at the Olympics as that, you know, my life was going to begin and end, whether it's positive or negative or whatever, after the Olympics, because so much was put into it. And since then, you know, I've just tried to think that I went through that for a reason, and if there's any chance of me competing in 88 and doing well, it's just going to be all that much better then.
So slowly but surely, John Moffitt seems to be erasing the evil thoughts from the blackboard in his mind. And as the defending NCAA champion in this event, we can assume that he is ready to go. The rest of the field here in lane one, Stuart Smith, a sophomore at Texas. In lane two, Giovanni Minervini, who's a freshman at UCLA, but he originally trained in Rome.
Andy Bauer in lane three, Moffitt in four, Rick Gill from California in lane five, Rick May, a junior at Texas from here in Austin in lane six, a senior at Arkansas, John Ulivari in lane seven, and Richard Schroeder, a 1984 Olympian in the 200-meter breaststroke, is in lane eight, a senior at UC Santa Barbara.
You'll notice that there's a slight cant and angle in the starting blocks for all of these swimmers, no matter what event at the start, and that helps them not hurt their ankles when they push off the blocks. It's so important in the breaststroke not to do a dolphin kick off at the start or you'll be disqualified.
Off we go. Remember, lane one, top of your screen. On the near side, lane eight. The man in the yellow cap on that front row right there is Richard Schroeder from UC Santa Barbara. And four lanes over is John Moffitt from Stanford University, the defending champion. He set a world record at the United States Olympic Trials last summer when he beat Steve Lundquist for the first time in a 100-meter race. And then that awful torn muscle. But he says that it is healed. We are above American and NCAA record time.
The breaststroke is perhaps the most difficult stroke from a coordination point of view, Al, because they have to do the arm recovery with both arms under the water, so there's a tremendous amount of resistance. They come off this turn, they're allowed to take one pull down stroke, and then you must come up swimming or you'll be disqualified. And Moffitt right now looks like he's going to win, and he's working on a stroke right now, concentrating on driving to the wall.
Moffitt, I will not break the record, 53-62, but he does win. And not only an important individual race for John Moffitt, but a race without a representative from Florida. And so 20 big points for the Stanford Cardinal, and they now have a strong lead in the team standing.
It's important in the breaststroke to concentrate on your stroke and your breathing. And here you can see Moffitt not lifting his head too high, keeping his head and chin perfectly straight, looking and eyeballing the wall, and also concentrating on pushing his arms straight forward with the most streamlined of positions so that he doesn't have too much resistance, enabling him to get the most out of his stroke when he pulls back for the water.
So, John Moffitt is the NCAA winner here. In first place, 53.62. In second place from lane six, Rick May of Texas. And in third place from lane five, Rick Gill from California. So John Moffitt's victory in the 100-yard breaststroke has given the Stanford Cardinal almost a 30-point lead over Florida, followed by Texas, California, and UCLA in the team race here. One of the most interesting stories here in Texas belongs to Peter Berndt. It is a story created by political boundaries, and behind those steely blue eyes are swirling emotions created by a different culture. Donna DeVerona tells us about a man who never felt at home when he was at home.
Peter Berndt's journey took him from his hometown in Potsdam, East Germany, to Fayetteville, Arkansas for an international swimming competition. Then on January 7th, during a stopover in Oklahoma City, Peter Berndt made a decision that would alter his life forever. While his teammates boarded a flight home, Peter made his way to the airport office to seek asylum. He left behind his country, his sister and father. Peter's strongest bond for his homeland was his mother, who had died 4 years earlier. He talked about his reason to defect.
The most important was myself, you know. I was unhappy with myself, about myself. And that I tried to find out what makes me unhappy, you know. I mean, in East Germany, everything is going about the government. Not just the sport. The study, the school, the job, the army, the sport, everything is going about the government, is supported by the government. But the thing here is that you can, if you want, you can be yourself, you know. You can go wherever you want, you can do whatever you want. But I couldn't do that, you know, so I need to defect, and that's why I said.
His new home centers around his education at the University of Alabama and swimming. NCAA eligibility, an obstacle at first, was resolved a little over a month ago. Much of his support and leadership comes from Alabama and 84 Olympic coach Don Gambrell. Open and inquisitive, Peter's adjustment to America includes a liking for fast foods and a newfound symbol of choice, a diamond earring. And of course, plenty of dreams.
I try to become a normal American. Well, I think a dream for me would be to do well in my study and to qualify for the Olympics. I will never get this chance again, the chance for a medal, an Olympic medal.
Peter Behrendt will never be accepted back in East Germany, but he has been accepted by the U.S. government and the NCAA, and now as a result of this performance by the Alabama Crimson Tide. This was Peter Behrendt in the 400-yard individual medley. This is Jeff Kostoff, a sophomore at Stanford, the eventual winner of this event. But Peter Behrendt was able to perform far above expectations.
And Peter Behrendt, who swam in lane number one at the top of your screen, the man who took second place in this event, was the former world record holder in the 400 meters individual medley, swam with an injured right hand. And once he gets that back into shape, he'll be able to improve upon his turns and become a lot closer to Kostoff, a man with a lot of confidence there, Al.
And a big victory for the Stanford Cardinal and for Jeff Kostoff and for Peter Behrendt. He has flashing thoughts of family and friends in Potsdam, East Germany, that he will probably never see again. His life began anew in Oklahoma City not too long ago, but here in Austin, Texas, another new chapter for Peter Behrendt. We'll be back.
One reason why Duracell batteries last so long is because we're always improving them. In fact, today's Duracell batteries will last up to 20% longer than the ones we made just 3 years ago. To do it any other way would be, well, the tail wagging the dog. Duracell, the copper top battery. When it comes to making them last longer, we never stop.
What's America's favorite do-it-yourself faucet? Peerless.
It goes in fast, it's built to last.
It's even warranted.
It lasts a long, long time.
No tools to use, you just can't lose.
And look, it doesn't drip. It lasts a long, long time.
Peerless washerless faucet installs in no time.
It lasts a long time.
It lasts a long, long time.
Peerless installs in no time, lasts a long time.
Monday, April 15th. Justice has a name. They call her Lady Blue.
Here at Sugars, we start the day early so that your lunch, your happy hour, and a full day of entertainment is ready when you are. The entertainment starts at 11:30 along with the mouth-watering Businessman's Lunch until 4, serving a variety of delectable morsels. Then happy hour takes over until 8 o'clock with free hors d'oeuvres, and the dancing continues till closing with the best dancers in Texas. At Sugars, we're ready. Are you? Sugars. Delightful any time of day.
I hate bugs. That's why I'm so good at my business. I love the Southwestern Bell Yellow Pages. It's where customers find me when they're bugged. My reputation and my Yellow Pages ad give me lots of calls. More calls mean more bugs to get. And that means more of these bugs to get them. Those little critters may outnumber me now, but I'm gaining on them.
The Southwestern Bell Yellow Pages, because nobody's in business to grow smaller.
If you don't vote, don't complain.
This will be the 100-yard freestyle, and the record holder is Matt Biondi of California, 42.36. He set it in qualifying here in Austin. His hero is Rowdy Gaines, who was the king in this event at the Olympics. Mark Spitz and Jim Lampley were there.
But right now, as they come down within 10 meters of the wall, the sentimental favorite, Rowdy Gaines, is going to win a gold medal. He's got it. Rowdy Gaines has won the 100-meter freestyle, a time of 49.80, a new Olympic record, and you won't see happiness all week to match that.
There is a very strong bond between Rowdy Gaines and Matt Biondi of California, who will swim in lane 4. And perhaps it is this bond that has pushed Biondi to new heights. The mark that he has already broken, I mentioned, the 100-yard freestyle mark of Gaines, was set by Gaines in 1981 in this pool. And not only that, Biondi has won the 200-yard freestyle here in Austin, and he broke Rowdy Gaines' record in that event. Now, next to Biondi is his Olympic roommate. That's him in the yellow cap, Tom Jager, a junior at UCLA. He has had a very successful trip to Austin, having already won the titles in the 50-yard free and 100-yard backstroke events. Also interesting is that Jager has never lost this event in the NCAAs. He is the two-time defending champion. But certainly without question, Biondi has the talent to break that string. The rest of the field from Caracas, Venezuela and Florida in lane 1, Albert Mestre. From UCLA in lane two, John Sauerland. From Southern Cal, Chris Kavanaugh. In lane three, Biondi and Jaeger. Mike Ellison in lane six from Texas. Jacobs from Texas in seven. Kramer in lane eight from UCLA. Three Bruins in this final of the 100-yard freestyle.
I think the strategy here is to go out as easy as you can and as fast as you can so that you can bring it home the last 50.
Take your mark.
Remember, it's Biondi and Jaeger, lanes four and five, right in the center of the pool. That should be the battle to watch.
I think it's matching wits between Biondi and Jaeger because both of them know how each other swim, and that is that they like to go out fast and increase their lead. So both of them have gone out into the lead, and they're trying to now pull away from each other. It's going to be very difficult. I project that it's going to be down to the wire, and Jaeger had absolutely the worst turn I've ever saw. He stretched out and just barely touched the wall with his feet, and that's allowed Biondi to get out into the lead, and I don't believe that Jaeger's going to be able to catch him because Biondi has the fastest turns, I think, in the United States today.
That was another great turn for Biondi. He is setting a record pace right now. Biondi has pulled away from Jaeger. Biondi's time, 41.87, a new American and NCAA record.
That was almost half a second under the time that he set earlier in the prelims. Boy, Tom Jaeger had the stroke of bad luck on that 50-yard turn. It allowed Biondi to get out in the lead, and certainly Biondi took full advantage of that.
A standing ovation for Matt Biondi from this crowd at the Texas Swimming Center. He sets the new record and breaks that long winning streak of Tom Jaeger.
Okay, here we see Matt Biondi at the top of the screen in the middle and Tom Jaeger with the yellow cap. Both men come into the 50-yard mark here, and you'll be able to see Jaeger turn. He turned exactly at the same time that Biondi did, but he hadn't had enough inertia to get in close enough to the wall. When he stretched out for his feet just barely touched the wall. He had absolutely no thrust off of it, and that allowed Biondi to get out in front of him.
So Matt Biondi wins the 100-yard freestyle, and what a happy man Mike Ellison of Texas must be, sneaking into second place, and Tom Jaeger of UCLA in third. Let's go poolside to Donna Devereaux.
Matt, your second NCAA victory and American record. You really shattered your best friend, Rowdy Gaines. He's standing right next to you's record. Comment on the race.
Well, Rowdy's been a big part of my my life as a motivation and a real good role model for me, and I'm glad that he could be here, because there's no other time I'd want to do it than have him watch it go.
Since 1981, you've held that record, and you broke it here. Fantastic talent, but how about the pool?
Oh, the pool was without a doubt the fastest pool in the world, and I knew he was going to do it. He keeps looking up at me. Now I'm looking up to him, literally.
Matt said earlier that he really did want to hear your comments if he broke the record. What do you have to say to him?
Well, I think Matt is definitely going to be the next leader of United States swimming. And we need those guys. We need guys that are out there that are bad, you know, that get out there and strike fear in other people. And I think Matt's one of those. And he's got a lot of responsibility now, and I know he can handle it.
Well, and they have. What a proud day for her to watch her son duel Mikhail Gross as the favorite in the 100 meter at the Olympics. But it turned out to be a learning experience. Jim Lampley and Mark Spitz were there.
Pablo Morales is in command if he can hold on. Here comes Gross. They are only inches apart in the middle of the pool, and Morales can feel every one of Gross's strokes. 20 meters to go. Mark, who do you like?
Morales has moved over to the right side of the lane. This may cost him a little bit of time. He's being miffed by Gross.
Gross is past him. Gross is going to touch him first. Absolutely. Mikhail Gross in a time of 53.08.
A new world record
has beaten world record holder Pablo Morales. And Morales also swam under his previous world record, but it wasn't enough.
Earlier, Donna DeVerona talked with Pablo Morales.
What did you learn from the Olympic experience, do you think? When you swam your best times, you tried your hardest, people went in with expectations of you. You've had reflections on that. Could you share that with us?
Definitely. I learned that things don't always happen the way you dream them to be. And what you got to do is take that in stride and concentrate on the next event. Things don't always happen exactly as you plan them. But if you put in the hard work, good races will come. So you have to take one race at a time.
We're standing by for the 200-yard butterfly championship final. The American record held by Craig Beardsley of 143.81. Pablo Morales of Stanford holds the NCAA record at 143.90. And here he is in the fastest qualifier lane, lane four. Already here in Austin, he has won the 200 individual medley and the 100 fly. And he is a heavy favorite to defend this title that he won 1 year ago. In lane five, Anthony Moss, a teammate of Pablo's from Stanford, but his home is Auckland, New Zealand. He had the second fastest qualifying time. In John Sieben's lane, lane six, we will see a very talented swimmer from Brisbane, Australia. He staged the biggest upset of the swimming competition at the 84 Olympics when he beat Mikhail Gross. And now the emotional favorite here in this race. Lane one, Bobby Patton. For 3 years now, he's been battling cancer. He discovered a lump under his right arm in the winter of 83, and the first of three operations was performed after the 83 NCAAs. Doctors even considered amputating his arm, but they did not. He has survived the operations and the emotional trauma created by it. He seems to be cured, except, of course, for his love of swimming.
Gentlemen, 200 yards of butterfly. Take your mark.
Bobby Patton in lane one, top of your screen from SMU. Florida's Mike Heath in lane two. Rafael Vidal from Florida in lane three. Morales, Moss, and Sieben in lanes four, five, and six. Ricky Green from Miami in lane seven. And Ricardo Prado in lane eight from SMU.
Pablo Morales' strategy here is going to be going out as easy as he can, but keeping up a very good pace at the 100-yard mark. He wants to be at a very fast time, somewhere around 50 seconds flat, for a pace to break the NCAA record and American record. And he knows that, I think in his mind, he's going to win this race. So he has to concentrate into the turn and out of the turn. He wants to keep his head down coming out of this turn, just like he did, avoiding that wave that's created by the other men that are in the field next to him. And then he breathes every other stroke. Occasionally he may take a breath every stroke just to get his rhythm back again and look at the wall so that he can turn. He is underneath American record and NCAA record pace. He wants to now concentrate on keeping his stroke very long, very much in control. It's very difficult to swim when you're out in front, keeping track of not only your competitors, but your pace and your stroke and your attitude towards trying to break a record. It's difficult.
Pablo Morales setting record pace here in lane four. And a body length in front of the field. Still under record time. And he is being challenged in lane two by Mike Heath of Florida. In lane five by Anthony Moss. And in lane six by John Sieben. It'll be a very close race for second and third.
He's about a half a second underneath the time at the 150-yard mark. The record is 1:43.81 by Craig Beardsley, 1982. His time early in the prelims was 1:43.90. So watch the clock.
Pablo Morales looking for his third title here. He's got it. And it's a new record for Morales, 1:42.85.
Almost a full second underneath that time. Boy, he just went out, concentrated on his stroke, concentrated on his rhythm and on his breathing, into the turns and out of the turns. And you can see that that's another couple of points for Stanford on their way, probably to, I think, the title.
And Mark, in that record time of 1:42.85, Pablo Morales has clinched his third NCAA individual title, the most since Brian Goodell did it in 1980. John Sieben in second, Anthony Moss in third, and our emotional favorite, Bobby Patton in sixth. He's a winner either way. And that will give Stanford an almost insurmountable lead in the team race. Coming up, the 3-meter diving championship.
If I thought that no one cared about the things I do in life, well, I'd still care about working hard and making it turn out right. Made in America, that means a lot to me. Oh, I believe in America and American quality. Here's to you, America. My best I give to you.
Anheuser-Busch is the same personal commitment to quality that has kept our family of beers the finest in the world for over 100 years.
Here's to you, America. My best I give to you.
Somebody still cares about quality. Anheuser-Busch.
Let's see.
Merrill Lynch reminds you your IRA is probably now a sizable investment.
Oh, with this year's $2,000, Steve, it's worth over $9,000.
And no one has more ways to invest your IRA.
Well, zero coupons are good.
Than Merrill Lynch.
Oh, utilities, CDs.
Call the people who help you manage your IRA as an investment instead of a deposit.
Great, let's do it.
Merrill Lynch people, a breed apart.
When you drive America's truck, there's one place you'll want to be.
On the road again. My boy trucking me on the road again. Work or play, there can't be any tougher friend. I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again. Just can't wait to see what's around the bend. When you drive a Ford, you're driving with a friend. My Ford trucking me on the road again.
Saturday on ABC's Wide World of Sports. An international field of riders continue to push body and machine on a course demanding finesse and power. They'll be cranking it up and pouring it on in the final of the Superbikers. Plus, the takedowns are fast and furious as the nation's top collegians grapple down in this premier competition, the NCAA Wrestling Championships, on ABC's Wide World of Sports, following the Professional Bowlers Tour next Saturday.
Welcome back to Austin, Texas, as we continue with the 1985 NCAA Swimming and Diving Championships. We change pools now, and we'll take a look at the 3-meter championship here in Austin. I'm Al Trautwig. Working with me is Cynthia Potter. And we're looking forward to seeing a group of divers today who are performing under the living legend of Greg Louganis. You, of course, remember his double gold medal winning performance in Los Angeles last summer. And Cynthia, I wonder what the overriding effect has been of Greg's performance on these divers.
Well, Greg continues to set such high standards in the United States and all over the world that these divers are trying to keep up with his standards. And as a result, they are performing the highest degree of difficulty dives that can possibly be performed on the 3-meter springboard. This contest comes down to who can do the dives without making mistakes.
Entering the final round, we have an anteater, a Buckeye, and a Razorback leading the way. Mark Bradshaw is in first place from Ohio State. Jim Gray is in second from Cal Irvine. And Ron Meyer from the University of Arkansas is in third. A word about the judging. There are 7 judges. We'll knock out the top 2 and the bottom 2 and multiply the middle 3 by the degree of difficulty to arrive at the final score. 10 dives down, only 1 to go, and here is the leader from Ohio State, senior Mark Bradshaw. He knows what it's like to be a winner and above the rest on the 3-meter board. He was the 1983 NCAA 3-meter champion. He has a 2.8-point lead ahead of second place Jim Gray. Right here, we will watch him perform a forward 3.5 somersault pike. Degree of difficulty, 3.1.
And this is his favorite dive. He does a nice dive, but he didn't quite get to the end of the board. Let's see what the judges think about that. Let's see if we can see Mark. Right here, he doesn't quite get his toes on the end of the board. So it doesn't allow him to go all the way up in the air and complete the dive as high as he could have.
3.7s, 4.7.5s. And for Mark Bradshaw, he stays in first place. A total of 6.60. This is Jim Gray, right behind Bradshaw in second place. From the University of California, Irvine, he is a senior. He had an unfortunate mishap in the 1-meter competition. He failed in his last dive and did not make the finals. As a result, people that follow him feel he is much stronger mentally coming into this event because of his determination to redeem himself.
He's doing a reverse 1.5 somersaults with 3.5 twists, a higher degree of difficulty than Mark Bradshaw's dive. It's a good dive, but he twisted a little bit on the entry. He's not quite square on his twist. Here's Jim's reverse 1.5 somersault with 3.5 twists. He has a real nice takeoff, completes the twist nice and high, but he doesn't square off on the end. He is not square with his body to the end of the pool.
And Cynthia, the judges agree, those marks won't help him at all. You can see the diving platforms here at the University of Texas at Austin. Right now on the 3-meter board is Kent Ferguson from the University of Michigan. He is a senior. The defending NCAA 3-meter champion and all academic Big Ten selection. He'll need 9.5 to take over the first place spot. His dive, his favorite, a reverse 1.5 somersault with 3.5 twists. Degree of difficulty, 3.3.
Nice dive, just a little bit too far away from the diving board. Ended up just a little short of vertical. Let's see if we can tell from this takeoff why he doesn't jump right up over the board. He needs to get his arms through early. Well, he has a little arch, and so he bellies out on the takeoff. Goes a little bit too far away from the diving board and leaves the dive just short of vertical.
The scores for Kent Ferguson, 2 7-5s and then 7s across the board. Good enough to move him into third, but certainly not good enough to challenge for first and second place. In 1980, Greg Louganis did something that has not been done since, win the 1 meter and 3 meter championship at the same NCAA meet. Here is Ron Meyer from the University of Arkansas. He has already won the 1 meter championship here in Austin, and he is in a great position to win the 3 meter.
Ronnie's doing the most difficult dive that can be performed on the 3 meter springboard. Reverse 3.5 somersaults tuck, 3.5 degree of difficulty.
Needs only 7s to take the lead.
I think he's going to get 7s on that. It's going to be close. He went out too far, but he got in just tight enough tuck to make the dive. There's Ronnie's reverse 3.5. It's very important for him to get in the tightest possible tuck he can, and that's what he's so great at. Look at that tight ball, and that's the reason he makes that dive.
An incredible victory for Ron Meyer. By 1/10 of a point, he eases by Bradshaw. What an incredible victory, repeating the effort of Louganis 5 years ago. It could not have been any closer. But this diving competition had little to do with the team competition. The Stanford Cardinal, the champions in a big way, and for the first time since 1967. So as you look at all the champions here in Austin, I'd like to bring in Mark Spitz again. How about a summary?
Well, Al, historically after the Olympic year, times aren't as fast. But Pablo Morales of Stanford and Matt Biondi of Cal and other swimmers set 9